Hi everybody, and welcome to our Kim's Upholstery Live, brought to you by Kim's Upholstery. Each week we share a project that we're working on with you. Some projects take several weeks, other projects are just a short one episode event. So this week we are going to be continuing working on that barrel chair, but we're ready to start the cushion. So we've upholstered all the body of the barrel chair and we got the cording in last week, and I finished it off camera because I didn't think you needed to see more glue dry. And this week we're gonna get started right in with the tea cushion that goes to that chair. So as you come in, come on in and say hello. Let us know where you're viewing from. Hit the like button so that we know that you're out there. And also go ahead and hit that share button so that you can share this event out with your friends as well. Because why not have more people join us and join in on the fun? For those of you on YouTube, you can go ahead and subscribe and hit that bell, and that way you will be notified when we do go live or when we add new content to our YouTube channel. So thank you everybody for hopping in and joining us today. Hopefully this tea cushion will go smoothly and we won't have any hiccups, but you never know. Technology sometimes is not our friend. So the cameras yesterday, we were doing some stuff, were giving us a little bit of trouble. So hopefully today everything will be nice and smooth. So I see some thumbs up happening. Thanks, guys. I can tell people are popping in. So thank you for joining us. And I invited some friends from Instagram over today, so hopefully they'll hop in here too as well. If you did come in from Instagram or Pinterest or something, let us know how you found this. So go ahead and let us know how you find us here on Kim's Upholstery Facebook, on our live or on YouTube. So hello, Jackie. Actually, I was just thinking about you today because we need to get a chair picked for your workshop. That's coming up. And hello Amy and Tammy and Joanne and Peggy and Gina and Bethany and Joan. Hey Joan. And Rita from Georgia. So thanks everybody. Those are the ones that I see on Facebook so far, and if I missed one of you, I apologize. I'd like to try to say hi to all of you and let you know that we know you're here. And YouTube will, as that feed catches up, we'll talk to you there as well. So I've made the cording for our project and I've gone ahead and serged it. If you remember when we were doing the cording to glue into the chair frame, we actually cut the lip off, but when you're sewing it, you don't want to do that. So I've serged all my cording and all my cushion parts ahead of time. I created a template out of the actual chair to make the top and bottom plates of my cushion. So this is going to be the top plate. I've marked my centers front and back so that just kind of keeps me oriented as I'm sewing. As I do try to join the cording close to the center in the back of the cushion, not always dead center, you know, off to the one side or the other a little bit, but it kind of gives me a, oh, hey, you're at the center when I'm sewing around the back of the cushion. I've also got our boxing strip here and I've marked the center on that as well. And in most instances, when you're making a cushion, one width of fabric generally isn't quite long enough. Sometimes you're lucky and it is wide enough for your cushion pieces, and other times it's not. So this one is not. So I've gone and added about 4 inches to one end of my boxing strip to help me be able to meet the zipper properly. You can sometimes make your zippers larger if you want, but the zipper already on this is coming up about 6 inches, and I really didn't want to bring it up any further than that. So it looks like some more people have hopped in here on Facebook. Hey, Lucky, thanks for joining us. And hello, Lori, thanks for coming. And hey, Bonnie, thanks for coming. And hello to you too in Canada. Are you guys warming up there yet? We are finally starting to warm up here. It's about 50 something today and sunny, and it's supposed to be 60 the next couple of days. So I'm looking forward to that. So like I said, I've marked my centers on all my pieces, but when I start sewing my cushions, I don't typically start in the center of the front. I start off on one corner and work my way around. I just like the results better. Sometimes if you start in the center, you might end up with a tight spot just because of the extra stitches right there in the center, and that's never a good look in your finished cushion. So let's go ahead and get all our pieces situated. I'm gonna put my boxing down on the sewing machine bed and figure out the placement of my cording here by wrapping it around the cushion. And I'm going to start at this far corner sewing the pieces together. You always get tangled up in your cording. So hello Herbert on YouTube. Thanks for hopping in and watching with us today. Gonna line my centers up. And you can use pins. If you're new to sewing cushions, using pins is not a bad thing. And you can always also, when you're first learning, because cushions are not easy. And oftentimes people think, oh, it's just a simple box cushion. How difficult can it be? It's all straight sewing, right? But when you do your first one, you'll find out there's a lot of variations that can happen. Your fabric's construction behave differently. And for all my upholstery work, I use a walking foot machine. And that is one of the must-have tools if you're going to do a lot of sewing or doing a lot of upholstery and you're making a lot of cushions. So a walking foot machine is a must, and that will eliminate probably 50%, if not more, of the problems you have in cushion fabrication. But you can also sew your cording to your top plate separate if you want, instead of sewing all three layers together. So, I mean, I've been doing this for years and years and years. So for me, sewing the three layers isn't a problem. But if it is for you, don't feel bad about starting by sewing your cording on first and then adding your boxing strip. Everybody starts at the beginning. None of us start at the experience level. So we all start at the beginning. And I use half-inch seam allowances when I sew. And I have blue tape on my machines to mark the half-inch. I use it myself, but it's mainly for students so that when they're here during workshops, they've got a reference. Because when you're not familiar with the sewing machine, like your own sewing machines, you get used to what a half-inch looks like. But when you're using a machine that's different to you, you don't always have a reference point. Because some of the throat plates do not have measurements on them when you get into the industrial machines, and some do. So I always have a blue tape here. So if you're wondering what that's for, that's why it's there. We had a great slipcover workshop here this weekend, and the ladies were more interested in learning all about the skills and techniques, more so than finishing their slipcover. So we had a lot of downtime and conversations talking about those different aspects of the slipcovers. So there's lots and lots of conversations. So I'm getting close to the corner here, and I'm going to go ahead and make a clip in my cording and my boxing so that when I pivot, I'll have a nice square corner. Oops, I'm stabbing myself with a pin that I've got marking where my roughly where my zipper comes to. Now this morning I was gluing the Dacron to my foam for this cushion so that I could have that ready so that when we get this done we can put it in the cushion cover. And of course I'm wiping my scissors down with the silicone saying, you know, this is really dangerous. I gotta be careful. And what did I do? I sliced my finger. So I have band-aids on and Bill's like, why did you do that? And I'm like, I don't know. I was just telling myself how dangerous it was. Stuff happens. So what's everybody working on for projects out there? Anybody working on any big cushion jobs? It's that time of year where all the spring cushions start to come in. I've got one coming up that's for a glider. Whoops, forgot to have my needle down. For a glider sofa, actually. It's not a glider chair. It's an actual sofa that's a glider. And we're doing one big, huge, long cushion for the seat. And then there's six back cushions. There's three on the back and one on each arm area. So now I am close to where the zipper is going to be. So hello Susan on YouTube, thanks for joining us. And what I'm going to do at this point is I'm going to flip the boxing out of the way because I need to join the zipper in the boxing end after, so I don't want to sew the boxing all the way. And then I'm going to continue just sewing the cording to the back of the cushion. And now I can go ahead and take that pin out. And then again, every corner I always clip the cording and your boxing strip so that you get nice pivots. We're actually having all of our kids over for Easter this Sunday, and I'm trying to plan. We're doing an Easter brunch instead of a dinner. So I'm trying to plan a meal. So if anybody's got any great suggestions for food items for a brunch, let me know. I'd love to hear them. I'm trying to do something different than what you usually do, you know? All right, so now I am, let's pick this up so you can see. So I've got the boxing sewn across the front with my cording in between it. and up the side, and I stopped short. My zipper ends about here. And then I brought the cording over past my center point so that when I join them, they'll be off to one side. So now let's go ahead and go in the other direction. And that's looking pretty good. You get that nice cording in there. You can't see any stitch lines, so it's nice and tight. So has anybody told me what projects they're working on, Bill? Starting to get warm in Canada. Hi, Stacy. Thanks for hopping in. Okay, so Peggy says, did you flip big piece? I'm not sure what you mean, Peggy. Hi, Tracy. Thanks for coming in. And Tammy says, I don't have a walking foot machine, but I'm getting into reupholstery, especially cushions. I have a Singer Industrial straight stitch machine. Is there an attachment for the machine that makes it work as a walking foot? Unfortunately, no, Tammy. The walking foot is the type of machine, and what it is it's a two-part foot system. So actually, here's the zipper foot. You can see it actually comes in two pieces. So the center one rides and works in sync with the dog feed, which actually feeds your fabric through much smoother. So if you struggle with cushions coming out like puckery and stuff, a walking foot eliminates all that. Happy Wednesday, Tracy. Tracy's working on the sofa. Bonnie just decked a chair. Let's see. Jana says oversized armchair. Joanne is working on a flex steel chair for her living room. Hello, Rhonda. Thanks for hopping in. And Tammy says, yes, I am reupholstering a cushion set for a wooden chair. Deanna, hello. Thanks for joining. And Sharon. And Deanna said, oh, this is live. Would have been good last week. Why, were you doing a cushion, a box or a tea cushion last week, Deanna? And Amy says she's working on a wingback chair and a scalloped awning. Yes, I saw your post on the scalloped awning. So we're going to have to talk about the time frame that it would take you to do that. Peggy says, is the fabric facing up? Yes, I did flip it over. Gotcha. So the fabric on the box on the cushion plate is now facing up, and my boxing is now down on top of it with the cording sandwiched in between the two. Gina is working on a captain's chair for a boat. And Deborah says, thanks for sharing. You are welcome, Deborah. And Tony says, hi, Kim and Bill from Los Angeles. Hi, Tony. And Sharon says, hey, Kim, from St. Vincent and Gerardine, and it's moving, sorry, Wisconsin, I think I saw it go by.
Grenadine,
Wisconsin, okay.
Grenadine, W-I, in the Caribbean, whatever that is.
Oh, in the Caribbean, okay, so it's not Wisconsin. All right, in the Caribbean. I missed that part as it flew by. Yep, so now I've got it, like I said, the cushion piece is face up and my boxing is on top of it face down. And again, when I get to the corners, I'm doing my clipping and spinning. Let's see, on YouTube, Susan says she's gathering materials to do her first project, which is an ottoman. Good for you. I hope you'll share pictures of us when you're done, Susan. If you hop on over to Facebook later, Susan, and go to the Kim's DIY Upholstery Hangout, you can come in there and share your project and ask questions along the way. And we have a great group in there that loves to share with one another. And a group of us actually are going to, I think there's about 16 of us so far, going to High Point, North Carolina this summer, which is going to be really fun. And some of us have never met in person, so it'll be fun to meet people face to face, even though you feel like we all know each other already anyway. And actually, there's a group of our members that are right now in Tampa at a conference called IWCE, and some of them are meeting up face to face for the first time and having dinner tonight. So they're going to share pictures later, I hope. It's always fun to eventually meet everybody. All right, so now I am at the end here, so I'm going to go ahead and again sew the cording the rest of the way around and leave that flap and come back and add the zipper in a second. Whoops, I forgot to take my pin out. And this cushion has a lot of curves going on. And luckily this fabric isn't one of those that really stretches out, because when you're sewing on the bias, you know how bad it can get sometimes. And this fabric is really good to work with. This is a greenhouse fabric. I don't remember what the name is, and I don't even know if it's still available or not, but it's a nice fabric. It's kind of like a linen-y look weave, but it's not a linen. It's probably a poly blend. All right, so now I am going to go ahead and join my cording pieces together. And the method I use, because you can't see close up, the method I use to join the cording pieces is one that we have on the tips and techniques in the membership portal for those of you that are members and haven't checked that video out yet. And it's also in the round footstool video. And it has become my favorite technique to join cording. And I think, Bonnie, you've tried it, because I think I remember you saying that you really liked this technique. Let's go open this a little bit so I can join these up. So does anybody paint furniture? Do any of you paint your furniture frames? I've got some stuff that I'd like to paint, and there's so many different paints and techniques and stuff out there. I'm just curious if any of you have used a specific brand or a technique that you really like. I like the chalk paints, but sometimes I find that they're hard to get the full coverage that I want. But when they're done, they always look really nice. So what I'm doing now is just opening the cording so I can join the ends here. Which, when you've serged it, it always takes a little bit longer to open these up. But I really like my cushion serged. Sometimes I'll serge it after it's all sewn together. It's just what kind of mood I'm in when I'm doing it. This one I just figured I'd serge ahead of time so that I didn't have to be sitting at the serger with you guys. That we could go right to putting the foam in the cushion. And I'm using a 4-inch foam for this chair. And I'm having the boxing finish at 3.5 because I really wanted a nice tight look. But I didn't want a 3-inch foam. I didn't want it that small, so. All right, let me join these ends here and then we'll be good to move on. Oops, I'm going to open that one a little bit further. Get the scissors where I need them here. Clipping the stitches without cutting the fabric. In fact, if somebody was just posting in our group, I think it was Bethany, that she had one of those oops accidents where she was serging her cushion and caught the bottom in the serger and cut her cushion piece, which is not fun when that happens. Kind of like the same thing, snipping here and hoping you don't cut anything. Cut off my excess. Thread tails everywhere. I don't care what you do, you always end up with more thread tails. Even if you think you've got them all clipped, you come back and there's always one or two more lingering around somewhere. All right, we are ready to close this part up. And when you don't hold on to the tails of your thread when you're sewing, it unthreads from the needle. Or sometimes it can jam your machine up, which is not fun at all. Did any of you see the video from this weekend where one of the students had never used an industrial machine and Bill got her on camera when she tried it for the first time? She was such a good sport and said, yeah, go ahead and put that out there. That's fine. So we've decided that we're going to invest in a second servo motor for that other machine so that both of these walking feet machine have the ability of going a lot slower. This one has the servo motor. And it really is much easier to control. But somebody was on this machine when she was using the other one. All right, so now we are in the back of the cushion. I have all my cording sewn together all the way around. So now we're going to go ahead and put in the zipper placket. And So this time for a zipper, and every time I do a zipper, I do it different. I've gotten, so this is my kind of go-to method where I've got finished fabric on both sides. I just like that look. And also when a client is opening and closing the zipper, and you know, like especially like outdoor cushions where they might be taking them off to launder or something, doing this method makes it so they don't have to worry about threads getting caught in the zipper because your threads are way out here. They're not right next to the zipper tape. So I've gotten to, I really like this method. And it's just a cleaner look. So I'm just gonna kind of walk this around. There's my center, there's my center. I'm gonna stick a pin in there just because it's easier moving around on camera and not trying to grab onto everything. So I don't lose stuff here. All right, walk it around. Got plenty on that side. Make sure I planned right, and I got plenty on that side, so we are good to go. And actually on this side, I think I probably got extra, so we might even end up, no, not really. I was gonna say we might even end up cutting it off, but I guess we're not going to. So, and I always make a little tuck at the end, so I make a pocket at the end of my zipper so that the slide, when your cushion is closed, the slide is hidden, and you don't see that zipper slide. Just kind of one of those things I'm particular about. A little zipper pocket. All right, so I'm just sewing the end of the zipper placket to the end of my boxing strip. Then I will go ahead and fold it back so I've got that pocket created, which will make sense in a second. I'll pull it out so you can see it once it's sewn. Keep all my edges lined up. One thing I find most often when someone's struggling with cushions is the inconsistency of your seam allowances. So when you're sewing, it's very critical to keep that seam allowance consistent the whole time you're sewing your cushion, because otherwise it is definitely going to come out wonky, and it's amazing how much like a quarter of an inch off at the end will actually make one of your pieces smaller or larger depending on which way you went with your seam allowance, whether it was too big or too small. So keeping a consistent seam allowance, like I said, I use half inch, some people use 3/4, but really consistency is the key. How many of you love cushions and how many of you hate making cushions? So if you have a walking foot machine, go ahead and give us a thumbs up. How many of you have walking feet machines? Like I said, this fabric is a dream to sew with. It's really nice. So let's see. We got any comments going on, Bill?
No, just one second.
Okay. So I'm clipping this next corner here. Go flip it around, and then I'm going to stop. I don't know why I didn't join those two ends together at the same time. I guess because I was busy talking to you. All right, so now I'm going to join that other end with the boxing. So Amy's got the whole week working on that scallop, which she's doing a awning, and it's pretty good size. Dana, it's behind the paper, Bill, so I can't see it. If you could shift it to the, nope, the other way. Deanna says, thanks for your videos. Instead of sewing my piping to my cover fabric and then the boxing, I sandwiched the piping and sewed all three at the same time. Helped to avoid any seams being seen when I was done. Good for you, Deanna. I'm glad you mastered doing that. Amy says, I have to do a T-cushion for the wing back, so perfect on the timing for this. Good. And Deborah says that she lives near High Point. So Deborah, hop into that Kim's DIY Upholstery Hangout and you can get into the conversation on that if you want to join us. Bonnie says, yes, it is seamless. I love it. Good. Deborah says, I do. So that must be I do to the and hand. So that's all the walking foot machines. Yes, I have painted and stained using general finishes and general stains. Gel stains, sorry. And gel stains. Yeah, I like the gel stains better than the liquid. So Rhonda uses the Annie Sloan paint. I've painted lots of pieces in my home. I've also used it, you know, on client pieces. So when you do, Rhonda, when you use the chalk paints, the Annie Sloan, do you use the clear waxes to seal everything? Amy says, aside from chalk, we use general finishes milk paint, but we spray our furniture too. I've never tried the General Finishes milk paint. That's a new one for me. Sheila says, for chalk paint, I love Paint Du Coco. I have tried plenty of others. Paint Du Coco is beautiful and finishes like butter. Okay, I'll have to check that one out too. And Bonnie's asking Rhonda if it adheres well. Some paints mark so easily. And that's the experience I've had too, with Bonnie, with the chalk paints, is they do mark easily and they chip off. Recently I've tried making my own chalk paint and I used a wax over the top, and so far that one stayed really well. So funny you laughed, silly. I'm not sure which thing, but... And then Phyllis Book joined. Hey, Phyllis, we haven't seen you for quite some time. You moved from I forget where to Virginia, and we kind of lost track of you. And hello, Alan. Thanks for popping in. Rhonda says she uses the clear wax. It does mark over time. I usually distress my pieces, so if it marks, it adds to the piece. I think you can use some finishes like poly. I've never used it, but it may give it a harder finish. Okay. Yeah, I usually do the distress look too, but sometimes it distresses where I don't want it to. So Tony says, that was so funny. I took off like a Maserati. Oh, the video they're talking about. Now I get it. Okay. Yeah, because I said to her, you're not driving, I forget, a Porsche or something. You're driving a Volkswagen Bug. And she just took off. And Rhonda says, thanks. Or Bonnie says, thanks to Rhonda. Hey, Missy, thanks for hopping in. Oh, hate cushions, love cushions. Okay, thumbs up. All right, so we got a mixture of feedback there. Nikki says she has a walking foot machine that is a heavy-duty domestic machine, and it works really well for all my upholstery projects. I'd love to know what brand it is, Nikki. I used a walking foot machine when I did the Craftsy class that was a domestic, and I wish I could remember what the name was, because that one was really nice, too. And it was actually a lot more expensive than these, which surprised me. Retha says she has a walking foot attachment on her Husqvarna Viking. Okay, I have one for one of my domestic machines, and I've never used it. So I'd like to know how you like it. Because I had bought it when I was doing a lot of quilts, and then immediately after stopped doing quilts, so I've never used it. It's still in the box, I think. All right, so I've just joined the second end of the boxing to the zipper. And now we'll finish this first side and move on to the second side. Now, if I'm not talking and on camera, I can do a whole cushion top and bottom with all this in a half hour. So obviously today it's taking longer than that because I'm yakking at the same time. Once you get good at cushions, they do go pretty quickly. You know, the cutting out and everything takes a little bit more time, but as far as the actual fabrication. All right, so now... And actually, Rhonda, who's on here, is hosting our Castle Rock, Colorado workshop at her place of business, which is also her home, called the Whimsical Chair. So if you have any questions about Castle Rock area and would like to join us for that, we have 3 spots left. You can reach out to Rhonda right here on Facebook. Go to the Whimsical Chair. Or you can go to our website and take a peek at it. And in Florida, we also have 3 spots left. That is in October, so I'm looking forward to that. These are both small chair upholstery workshops. And then in Virginia, we have one coming up in November, in Galax, Virginia. I keep forgetting how to pronounce that. So there you go. There is our whole top cushion sewn to the boxing, into the zippers. And let's just take a peek and see if we've got any stitch lines showing anywhere. Nope, because this is the time to check it. You know, you check as you go around, and if you've got a spot where the stitching is showing, just run over it again and go a little bit tighter, unless your seam allowance is off. If your seam allowance isn't accurate, then go ahead and pop it out. But typically, if you just run it in the opposite direction, oftentimes you can get nice and tight up there. So now let's go grab the second side of our cushion and our cording. And at this point, I need to make my registration marks for where my corners and things are. So I will go ahead and do that as well. First get some of these threads out of the way. Snipping them all off. And you want to mark as accurately across from your previous corner as you possibly can. And sometimes it's hard to get it exact, but you really want to pay attention to the grain of the fabric or whatever you can use to help you do that. And also folding the fabric the right way will help with that as well. So I'm going to mark the T's on this. And then there is an actual corner in the back, even though it's curved. It's got one part that was enough that I should be able to find that and mark it. You really want to have an orientation when you're sewing to make sure things are lining up. And while I'm getting this part ready to sew the second time, if you could go ahead, anybody who hasn't yet, and hit that share button for us and spread the word. Invite some of your friends to come in here and join us on this live. Who knows, you may have other upholstery attic friends that you don't even know are into this. All right, so there's that back corner. Upholstery is definitely an addiction. A good addiction, but it's an addiction. It's like you do that very first piece. You're like, oh, I just got this one piece, I'm gonna try it. And then before you know it, your garage or shed or basement is full of all these orphan pieces of furniture you found side the road. Anybody else have that happen? Or you go to a flea market or a tag sale and you're like, oh, that chair could be gorgeous, I gotta get it. Bill's laughing. In fact, it's that time of year, don't tell Bill, shh. But spring is coming and that's when people start putting their furniture side the road. And we also have colleges around here, so the college students will have gotten these really great pieces from grandma or whatever to have at college, and then at the end of the year, they just throw them side the road because they're going home and they don't have any place to put them. So we drive around the college campuses, or not the campuses, but the off-campus housing too. Shh, don't tell Bill. Right, Bill?
Yeah.
So I've actually got a seam right here, and I don't want to start my cording with a seam where I'm going to have to be joining. So I'm going to go ahead and cut this right off. And then plan my attack. Oops, I'm kind of going backwards here, aren't I? Go this way. And the other thing I try not to do is have my seams from my cushions staggered on top of each other. I try to have them staggered left to right so they're not lined up that way as well. All right, so I've walked it around, and when I walked it around, I ended up with a seam right smack in the corner on my cording, and I don't want that. So I'm just gonna go ahead and jog that seam that way so that it is off to the side. I'd rather have it somewhere in the T than right in the center of my cushion or at a corner. All right, so I'm lining my corners up, getting my mark at my seam allowance, and I am gonna go ahead and stick a pin in here to hold these together while I get this situated, so that I don't lose it and have to do that all over again. Of course, if you put the pin on the right side, it helps. There we go. All right. Now get it back under the machine, and I'm ready to sew. So what I usually do, too, is I put it underneath this presser foot and just check myself to make sure when I'm coming around, I'm landing nicely with the other corner as well. Because if you're, like I said, if you're off a smidge, it could throw it off at the other side, and then you'll be hating yourself because you're going to have to pull all those stitches out. So it's like measure twice, cut once, check twice, sew once. Hopefully, right? What's the most times you guys have had to tear apart a cushion and redo it? I think I had one years ago that was a velvet, and I must have torn that thing apart 10 times and redone it. And that was before I had a walking foot machine. It was I had an old Singer. 3115, I think, was the number on the Singer. And that thing, it was really rugged and sewed really well if it didn't involve cushions and going around corners. So now I'm just on the second side, and at this point I've got my cushion bottom on top, and then I've got my cording and my boxing is again against the sewing machine bed. And I don't have any pattern match here, so I'm not worrying about any of that. If you have pattern match, you really want to pay attention. And when you're planning out your pattern match, like I demonstrate in that slipcover tutorial, in fact, we had a lot of questions about that last week on our Q&A. And just because it's a slipcover tutorial doesn't mean it doesn't have things in there that are applicable to upholstery. And in there, we talk about the pattern match and placement and how to figure out your cuts. So when you're making anything with a pattern match, you really want to pay attention, make sure your measurements are accurate, and include your seam allowances, because I think that's one of the biggest mistakes is the seam allowances are forgotten, and then when you go to sew your pieces together, it's off literally like a half inch to an inch, depending on if you forget on both or not. And in the workshops, I discourage pattern match pieces or, you know, bringing fabric that's pattern matched, because I really want you concentrating on the skills that you're learning and not on something that's a totally another skill. So pattern matching and placement and all that is another skill set on top of the skills of upholstering or slip covering. spin this around. And these armpit areas on the T cushion is a lot of times where people will pull too much, and you can really get your cushion out of whack by yanking on those areas. So you really have to be conscientious of what your hands are doing all the time. So did anybody answer my question, Bill, on how what's the most times they've had to take a cushion apart?
I think so.
Alright, so I just went over my first pocket here. Hey, Carol, thanks for hopping in. Bethany's headed to the shop now. Happy stapling, everyone, she says. You too, Bethany. Hello, Pam, thanks for joining. Polyvine is a good top coat that gives a wax-type finish, but is a poly, and generally finishes flat out. Will play and give you a... Wait a minute, I'm missing it because it moved, sorry. Finishes flat out, flat, will play, give you... So it gives you some play and gives you a chalky look, but it's still poly finished. Polyvine, I've never ever heard of that, Gina. Huh. Hey, Colleen, thanks for hopping over and joining us today. Bethany says, I wonder what my cushion would look like if I was sewing, talking, looking at a monitor, and talking to people and being recorded. I don't know, Bethany. Let's try that sometime and see what happens. Rita says, my first cushion I made had stripes in it, and I tried to match the stripes, but I was off by a half inch on the band. Yeah, it happens. JD says, I make it look easy. Well, it is when you've been doing it for 22 years. Plus, I've been sewing since I was about 9 years old, and we're not going to give you that total. But so Deanna says, I did a large chenille bench that I probably ripped seams about 12 times. It kept shifting, and my corners wouldn't line up. It was the pre-walking foot. Yeah, the walking foot definitely makes a difference. Haha, when I had the house, I would drag all kinds of furniture home. Found while walking the dog, driving around, etc. And that's from Tony. I can hear ya. So, all right, so I'm going to go ahead and snip at my corner. And we'll go ahead and pivot. And move around to the back. Now I left this side short because if you remember I jogged it one way to get that seam off the front edge of my cushion because we don't like that. We don't want seams on the front end of the cushion in our cording. And I typically use, because people ask this question a lot too, I typically use always use bias, but I typically use a 54 inch piece of material, so like a yard and a half, to create my cording because I don't like a bunch of 25 inch pieces of cording strips with all those seams in it when I fabricate something. I really want to try to get the front of my projects as clean as possible and not have those joints. I mean, some fabrics you can't see the joints at all, so it's not super critical, but it's not a look that I like. So when you're doing custom work, you want to take that extra step and make everything look really good. All right, so now we are back around the side. Let's check the corners. That one looks good. That one looks good, and that one looks good. So far all the corners are lining up. No shifts, and now we're gonna go the other way. Probably jinxed myself right there, didn't I? Nah, all it's gonna go well. All right, so now I wanna clip my cording before I get started here. So we were having a discussion in the group the other day too about sewing machines, and walking foot is the main thing that you want. The brand isn't quite as critical. I mean, I have my Jukies. I love my Jukies. I've got three of them, three different Jukies. But Brother makes a good one. Pfaff makes a good one. I haven't heard, I'm trying to think, Oconso is another one that makes a good one. I think Carol has Oconso and you're on here watching. But what brands do the rest of you have for walking foot machines? And if you can find a secondhand one, that is awesome because these things don't have hardly anything on them that can go wrong. I suggest you always have an extra bobbin case and ask me why. We had a big project one time and of course I was like in a hurry being rough on the machine and I busted the bobbin case and then couldn't finish the big project on time until we could get another bobbin case in. So we have extra bobbin case all the time. I have plenty of bobbins. I'm trying to think. We've never had to replace the belts on any of these, have we?
No.
I don't think so. Our old Singer we had to replace a couple times on that. But yeah, I think the bobbin case is the only thing I've ever wrecked on, and I think it was actually the other walking foot machine, which is an older Juki.
Tell them our story of fixing the sail that machine the night before the slipcover workshop.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so here's one of those keep it simple, stupid moments. We were setting up the night before our slipcover workshop this weekend. So Friday afternoon, it's, 3 o'clock on a Friday. I'm just doing the last minute oiling on the machines, testing them, putting on new needles, making sure everything is good to go. So I get out my sail-right machine, which I always have in the classes because there's always a couple students that are not familiar with industrial. So we get the sail-right machine set up and I cannot get that thing to sew to save my life. It is making a mess, it's chewing up thread, it's getting stuck, and I'm panicking, and you know how it is, the more panicked you get, the worse things get. So I'm finally, like, after a half hour going, Bill, can you help me with this machine? I cannot get it to work. So he's after me because I waited till 3 o'clock on a Friday to do this. So he sits down, he messes with the machine, we get the manual out, we take the whole bobbin case and everything out underneath a part, and we put it back together, it's still doing it, and we do that probably, what, two times, Bill? Two times. We take it apart. I change the needle. Dummy me did not realize that the arm up here at the top where you thread your thread through wasn't threaded, and that was the whole problem. So after like an hour and a half of messing with this machine, it was like, huh, thread's not through there. I wonder if that's it. And worked like a charm. So keep it simple, stupid. Check all those basic things first before you freak out like I did. And it did get used in class, luckily, so. It was all worth it, but I was not happy with myself. And it's like you know that in your head, you know that it's usually the simplest thing. So. Hey, Carrie, thanks for stopping by. Donna tells me you're doing an awesome job on her new website. So now we are coming towards the back. And then we'll be ready to go put in our foam. So what's your, like, stupid moment with your sewing machine that you ever did? Somebody's got to have something out there, not just me. Yeah, oftentimes, the simplest things are change your needle, because it's usually your needle. Once in a while, I've had it happen where it's been an old spool of thread, and that's been my problem. So Colleen says, four times, the first cushion I didn't have to do any tear out was a velvet. Go figure. Yeah, you never know. It's the ones you think are going to give you the most problems tend to be sometimes the easiest ones. Yeah, my one velvet one, the very first velvet I ever did, I was like pulling my hair out. But like I said, I did not have a walking foot machine either. Hi, Kim. Yes, working on it as I type. So you're multitasking too, Carrie. Carrie's business is Midnight Suns Designs, and he does some beautiful website work if anybody is looking for websites. You can go ahead and post your link to your website in here if you want, Carrie. All right, so now I'm getting up to where I have to join the cording again. And I did make a little bit of extra. I tend to make extra cording, and I always keep it wrapped up in a corner. In a corner, I have a basket full of pieces of cording because you never know when you're going to get that project in that you're doing a pillow and you've got something that would be a great contrast. All right, so I'm at the point where I need to join them. And it's just easier to have the boxing on the bottom when I do this. Oops, there's my little piece here. Go ahead and get these trimmed so I can join the ends. And there's the garbage can down there. I'm not just throwing them on the floor. Although, when I'm upholstering in the back room, everything goes on the floor till the end of the day.
Is Carrie going to pod camp?
So, Carrie, Bill wants to know if you're going to pod camp. I don't think we're going to go this year. We just got too much going on. Actually, it's
next weekend,
isn't it? Yeah. So PodCamp is like a place for geeky people like us who like to do video and social media stuff. And it's an on-conference conference. It's really cool. I think they have them in other parts of the country, too. This is, what, the 10th or 11th year in Massachusetts, I think?
10? This is maybe the longest running one.
Yeah, I think this is the longest running. So what it is you go there, and all these people that do different things related to social media and marketing and videos and YouTube and all kinds of stuff show up. And you start putting tickets on a board, sticky notes on a board telling you what you'd like to learn, and then people will say, I can teach that, and so it just kind of, the classes evolve that way, and it's really cool, and it's always a really fun group of people, but we've just got so much going on that I don't think we're going to make it this year. I know we're not going to make it this year. Because we've got Easter this weekend with the kids, and then I don't think anything's going on the weekend after that, but I got work to do to get done, and I've got a section out here in the front room that we'd like to paint for a backdrop for some of our video stuff. So JD says, so I have done it because I was told to do it this way, but why do we sew a cushion from a certain point on the right and then go back and do it from the other point on the left? You did it with this cushion. So the reason for that is, JD, if you think about this. So if you're sewing a cushion and you're sewing the top, and you start, let's say you start in the center of the back, and you go all the way around to the side, then when you flip the cushion over and you're doing the same thing, you're sewing in the other direction. So what you end up doing sometimes is racking the boxing so that they pull away from each other, because now you've sewn in two different directions. So if that makes sense. So this way, if you're going both directions, you're pretty much splitting it up. So everything is stretching equally this way, if it's stretching at all, which you hope it's not, but it does sometimes. All right, I'm getting the sign that we're getting towards the end, and I'm not done with my cushion yet. Kim, stop talking. So Deanna says, last week my bobbin thread kept looping out of the bobbin case. I cleaned the machine, cleaned the lint out, checked how I threaded up the machine to realize that I had put the bobbin in the case wrong. See, it's always those simple things, and you immediately freak out, think something's broken, I gotta change my tension, and it's just some kooky little thing. It's like, looking at it, I cannot believe that I didn't see that thread was not threaded in the machine right, because that's usually one of the first things my eyes go to. I kind of just go do 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 do, yeah, it's all threaded right, and just didn't do it. I just immediately went into panic mode. Which doesn't happen to me too often. I'm pretty even keeled. Right, Bill? He's not.
Sometimes I'm not listening.
He's not listening. What do you mean, sometimes you're not listening? That happens frequently. He says he tunes me out because I talk to myself, I talk to the cats, I talk to the fabric. He's like, I don't know when you're talking to me and when you're talking to something else. How many of you out there talk to yourself? Be honest. I work out problems with myself. I sit there and talk it out to myself, and it's like, yeah, you're right, that would work. Let's go try it. Maybe I'm a little weird, I don't know. Okay, we're ready to finish this up. Get the foam in the cover, yeah! Just opening the seam in my cording, or not my cording fabric. And butt them up against each other, sew it shut, and we're ready to go to the table and stuff it. If I can get everything in there. And make sure I'm not catching pieces underneath, because it almost felt like I was. Nope. Okay, now I ended up with about a quarter of an inch extra, or half an inch extra of fabric here. So let's take a look. Let's see if I go back to my corner. That looks on. That looks on. So let's see now, how do we fix this, right? This is where you got to figure out how much you got to take out, and sometimes it's just a matter of taking out a little bit and easing it in, which I think it is. I think if I take it out back to here, I can probably ease it in and get rid of that. So let's do that. See, so it happens, and it's literally like less than a half an inch, probably 3/8 of an inch that I have here. Where's my other ripper? This one's a little bit dull. Let me grab... there's a seam ripper up here. Let me just go grab this. Just pop that out. So usually when it's just that, a little amount, I don't have to go back too far, and it doesn't happen all the time. just every once in a while. Okay. What I like to do when this happens is actually sew the cording to the top piece, or in this case, the bottom of the cushion, get that attached, and then ease it with the boxing from the zipper placket. So we're going to do that. So we might go a couple minutes over to get this done for you. Sounds like the machine might be messing up here. Let's check that out in a second. Try it a little bit further and see what happens. All right. Yep, it sounds like it's... See, so it's all going to go wonky at the same time. There we go. And you know what it probably is? I'm probably at the end of my bobbin. Sometimes when that happens... Nope, I'm not at the end of my bobbin. Aha, but I did get an extra tail that showed up here in my bobbin. So let's just set that one aside and put in a new one. And I'll mess with that after. That's another thing I like about the industrial machines is I can always have a bobbin winding while I'm working, so there's never any downtime. You can just go to the next one. Quick and easy to change. Get rid of this tail. And there we go. There, now I can tell it sounds just right now. Can you, are you at a point where you can hear too when your sewing machine goes funky? It's like the minute it makes an odd sound, I pick up on it. Did anybody share what kind of industrial machines they had, Bill?
They may have.
I'm just trying to hold the ends of the cording closed because I got that one section where it's not sewn shut where I joined the ends. All right, so now I've got the cording sewn to the bottom of the cushion. And now we'll go ahead and reattach the boxing. These threads that I have here. So usually when they don't meet up, it's a quick fix like that. Sometimes it's more drastic, but the more cushions you sew, the less often that happens. I think the hardest cushions to sew without, or hardest fabrics to sew without a walking foot are sombrella fabrics, chenilles, and velvets. Those are the ones that you end up having the most problems with.
Carol has a conso and a fabricator, which is the sail right, right?
Fabricator is the sail right, that's right, yeah. Lots and lots of tails. Yeah, I know that Carol has posted before that she really loves her conso. That it's, and that was secondhand, I believe, right, Carol? That you found that? Which, if you can find a secondhand walking foot or industrial of any kind, grab it. All right, so once I sewed the cording to the top of the, or bottom of the cushion in this case, and then sewed the boxing on after, I was able to ease everything in, and it worked out just fine. And literally, all I had to do was ease it in and get rid of that 3/8 inch. Let's cut some threads and let's head on over to the table and we will go ahead and stuff it. Kind of sounds like Thanksgiving dinner, right? You're getting stuffed. Let me just unzip this here. Turn it right side out. Actually, let me cut a few more threads here. Not that they'll ever show, but And like I said, I serged all the parts before I fabricated the cover. So everything has been serged. If not, at this point, I would have run it through the serger. And I've already gone ahead and put the Dacron on the top, bottom, and front of my cushion, as well as the ends of the tees. I typically don't put Dacron on the sides if it's going in between the arms of a piece of furniture, or on the back, because I don't want it, the Dacron to bump it out further in the chair.
That looks like you're going to have to...
It's going to squeeze. Let's see if I can squish it in instead of vacuum it. Let's find it. Can she do it? Bill's shaking his head. Sometimes I can get them in without the vacuum cleaner. This one doesn't look it, does it? But we'll see. Ready? Can we fight it in here? Who's going to win? Kim or the cushion? Come on, guys. Cheer me on. Give me some thumbs up. Let's get this cover on. Look at that. See, with you guys cheering me on, I can get it in there. And you also want to make sure that you're putting all your seams in the same direction. Most often I put my seams towards the boxing, but every once in a while I'll get a fabric that looks better the other way. Okay, the front's in. Can we suck the back in? Cut the foam the same size as the finished cover, and then it always looks like, how the heck am I going to get that in there? But I did say that I, or mentioned, and I may have to tweak this corner, that I am using a 4-inch foam and a 3.5-inch boxing, because I did want a really tight look here. And there's always some finessing you got to do after it's in the cover. Go ahead and push this down. See, I'm going to be good when I get to Chauvin. I'm going to be ready to tackle those alligators because I tackle cushions. I'm going to stick this on the floor. Alligator wrestling. I'm going to stick this on the floor so I can push it down to zipper it shut, because that way it's below me. And it's going. Going. And I'll still have some smoothing to do when I'm done here. There we go. So now it's just a matter of smoothing things out, shifting things around, getting the fabric in the right position. And you can see how nice and tight that is. We won. The cushion lost. But again, like I said, I've got to go smooth this around, push it around. Hopefully I don't have to open it up to shift any seams down, but sometimes I do if one pops up. And it's just working it to get everything in there, getting your T's all in there. Cross your T's, dot your I's. Okay, guys, I think we won. Kim, 1 point. Cushion, 0. Now let's put it in the chair. Still probably needs a little smoothing, but get it in the chair and check it out. And look at that. Perfect foot. Fit. Perfect fit. Nice on the front. Let's check it out and see how comfortable it is. It's very comfy. Bill, can we keep it? Bill's like, no more furniture. So there you have it. Our chair is complete. Our cushion is in. Everything fits nice. And we got it in there. It's like putting 10 pounds into a 5-pound bag, right? But we did it. So let's see. What are the comments going out here? Deanna, I've done that a couple times too. Duh, right? Yep, I get you guys. I just started it. Thought it was going to get old. I'm not sure what that's a reference to. I type myself to work out projects.
Yeah. So he types instead of talking
to me. Oh, types to yourself. Gotcha.
I send myself emails.
Bill sends himself emails. He's always like sending himself emails. And Deanna says, I tell myself, let the fabric tell you what it wants to do. Breathe. Don't freak out just yes. Perfect, Deanna. In fact, wait, you got to see the t-shirt I just made for myself. I'll show you guys when I get it. Tracy says, Jonathan spent time in the shop with me last week. I told him I needed to have a conversation with myself for a while so he didn't have to pay attention. That's a good one. Colleen says, all the time, how long have you and Bill been married? Well, Bill and I have been together 26 years and we've been married 11. Bonnie says, all the time, and my husband always asks if I'm talking to him. Bill does the same thing. Tony says, yep, I talk out loud all the time. People ask, are you talking to me? And there, Carol was talking about her console and her fabricator sewing machine. Tammy says, I've worked at a workshop making draperies, and we use a monofilament thread so that we don't have to change the thread for each job. Have you ever used the monofilament thread for upholstery or for slip covers? I did use it for a while, and I found my machines always bogged up, so I stopped using it. Deanna says, my Juki was in pristine condition secondhand, only a couple years old and half the price. Awesome. Did you crown your cushion with a second layer of Dacron? No, Deanna, I did not, but because I used a smaller boxing than the foam, it actually crowns it a little bit naturally. JD says, I have an old one called a Glyco. I'm not familiar with that brand. How would you use a vacuum? Well, to use a vacuum cleaner, you'd use plastic. You'd wrap the foam with plastic and then suck it down with a vacuum cleaner. If you look in the Kim's DIY Upholstery Hangout, Retha, there is a picture that Bethany shared where she was doing that. Anna says, I also would like to know how you use a vacuum. So, yes.
We have a video on YouTube.
We do. There's a video on YouTube, too, that we created about that. Look, somebody called it magic or something. Looks adorable. Love it. Now you need to rest. Looks great. Why would you use a vacuum? So to suck down the foam. So what it does is it actually shrinks the size of the foam, makes it pop right into the cushion easily. Lee says, when you say if you can buy an industrial, what do you say? What did you say your machine did? Okay, so an industrial machine is just more heavy duty than a domestic home sewing machine. And, you know, they come on the tables and everything. So they're just a much more rugged machine for doing this kind of work. Karen says, I bought Reliable Barracuda and have not been happy with it at all. Please don't recommend it to anyone. I would have spent a bit more to get a good one. Good to know, Karen. Thanks for sharing that. So thank you, everybody, on Facebook and on YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this week's episode of Kim's Upholstery Live. And next week, we are going to be working on a little wooden chair project that actually has a box pleat skirt. So it's a wooden armchair that has a loose seat cushion and an upholstered seat with a box pleat skirt. So we're going to start that next week. So thank you again, and all of you join us next week right here on Wednesday as well. And those of you that are members, we will be live at 3 o'clock in the member portal this afternoon with our Wednesday's Q&A. So bring your questions and come on over and let's talk cushions maybe this week. So thanks, everybody, and have a good rest of your week. And happy Easter to those of you that celebrate.